Geronimo was born on June 16, 1829, in what is now the state of New Mexico. He was raised by his parents in Apache traditional ways. When he was 17, he got married and had three kids. He lived a happy and peaceful life with his family. But soon, this would all change. On March 6, 1858, 400 Mexican soldiers who were under the command of Colonel Jose Maria Carrasco raided Geronimo's camp while the men were out of the village. When Geronimo and the rest of the men returned, they found their village destroyed, and everyone who was alive before they left were all dead. Amongst the dead people were Geronimo's mother, his wife, and his three children. Geronimo was infuriated and swore vengeance on the Mexicans. After that tragic day, Geronimo hated every Mexican with a passion. Geronimo was chosen by his chief, Mangus Coloradus, to help the Cochise band in revenge against the Mexicans. Driven by his emotional distress of losing his family, Geronimo savagely raided and killed several Mexican people. The anger he felt towards the people who killed his family fueled him with aggression as he raided the Mexican states of Sonora and Chihuahua, often disregarding his own life as he charged into Mexican troops with only a knife. Dodging bullets and savagely stabbing people, Geronimo fearlessly marched on. Soon after the first raids on Mexican territory, Mexico placed a bounty on Apache scalps. $100 for an Apache warrior and $50 for an Apache woman. Geronimo's fighting tactics earned him respect amongst other Apaches. This was one of the main reasons why so many Apache men chose to follow Geronimo on the warpath against those who killed his people and destroyed his home. The other main reason why so many Apaches followed him was based on the way he evaded capture from both Mexican and U.S. troops. Many believed he possessed several powers, such as being able to survive gunfire. Geronimo was shot several times, but survived. Another was to transform into rocks to evade enemy capture. And perhaps the most famous of his supposed powers was being able to disappear without a trace. An example for one of these stories happened in the Robledo Mountains of southwest New Mexico. Geronimo, accompanied by his followers, entered a cave. U.S. soldiers waited outside the same entrance that Geronimo used to enter, but he never came out. Later, Geronimo was spotted in a nearby area, which left the U.S. troops baffled because they never found a second entrance to the same cave. And yet, till this day, that second entrance hasn't been found, and the cave is still called Geronimo's Cave. It was events like this that made Geronimo a hero and made Apaches even more eager to fight alongside a warrior like Geronimo. He gave hope to other Native Americans as he refused to surrender and give in to the white settlers who saw Native Americans as inferior people who weren't good for nothing. This was also another reason why Geronimo kept fighting. He refused to become a prisoner or a slave, something that too many of his people had already become. This was the reality that Geronimo was beginning to realize, but he still fought against U.S. troops even when he was outnumbered. The white settlers were taking over what the Native Americans had once called home, and Geronimo felt this was unjust. Bob Hassaus, a Chiricahua Apache, talks about these unjust and wrongdoings in this interview from the documentary of the Apache Indian Resistance.
Went through this whole area. The Navajos and had lost tremendous numbers. In fact, my mother's father was either the son of a slave or else a slave himself. They needed the cheap labor just like they needed the black labor from Africa, and here it was Indian people because we were still subhuman to them, just another beast of burden. This land to Apaches is a living entity and it's sacred. But to white people, it means minerals, it means gold, it means silver and copper and coal. And the Indian indigenous rights didn't mean anything to them.
In 1876, the Chiricahua Apaches were forcibly moved out to a reservation by U.S. troops. But Geronimo and a few others fled to Mexico, avoiding capture. Shortly after, he was arrested and returned to the reservation, only to escape again. For a decade, Geronimo stayed on the run, evading U.S. capture again and again. The media exaggerated Geronimo's actions and portrayed him as a very dangerous and savage Apache, striking fear into everyone who heard these exaggerated stories. In May of 1882, Geronimo was apprehended by Apache scouts working for the U.S. Army. He surrendered, but after a year on the reservation, he escaped after hearing rumors of impending trials and hangings. Geronimo was on the run again, but this time with 35 warriors and 109 women and children. On March 25, 1886, Geronimo would surrender for the last time. After surrendering to General Miles, he was transported to be a prisoner of war in Fort Marion and Pickens. Little did he know, he had become famous and was now a hero to Native Americans everywhere, and a celebrity to everyone. While a prisoner at Fort Sill, he was allowed to join the military. Geronimo would charge tourists to take pictures of him or with him. He would also sell his handmade goods, like arrows and clothing, and would also charge for his autograph. People would expect to see the savage man they had heard about, but instead, they got to see an old, peaceful medicine man, which was the true identity of Geronimo. These events were witnessed firsthand by an Apache who was very close to Geronimo. His name was Jason Betzines. He wrote a book titled I Fought with Geronimo. And in this book, he wrote a passage describing how people really had believed the exaggerated stories they had heard about Geronimo. One day, I acted as an interpreter for a writer who asked to see Geronimo's coat, made of 99 human scalps. On hearing this, Geronimo was speechless. He had no such coat. It never was his custom to scalp his fallen enemy. He didn't know what to say to this man. Finally, he just turned and walked away. I fought with Geronimo, Jason Betzines. After being a prisoner for over 20 years, Geronimo realized that he should have never surrendered. Had he known his people were going to be imprisoned for so long, he would have never surrendered. Geronimo pleaded with President Teddy Roosevelt, asking him to please free him and his people. He wrote to Roosevelt several times, "It is my land, my home, my father's land, to which now I ask to be allowed to return. If this could be, I might die in peace, feeling that my people placed in their native homes would increase in numbers and that our name would not become extinct. I pray to you, cut the ropes, make me free. Let me die in my own country, an old man who has been punished enough. Geronimo." Roosevelt refused his last request. It was said that on his deathbed, Geronimo confessed that he regretted his decision to surrender. On February 17, 1909, Geronimo died and was buried at Fort Sill in the Apache Indian Prisoner of War Cemetery. Because Geronimo experienced the horrific atrocities in the early years of his life, which included losing his family to Mexican troops, caused him to do what he felt was necessary, raiding villages and refusing to surrender. And the results of his actions led to him becoming the man he was known for, Geronimo, the American legend.